Lo último que vimos en la clase anterior fue este resultado. El resultado establecía básicamente que el conjunto de este tipo de funciones, las funciones exponenciales definidas de esta forma, para cada un número entero, estas formaban un conjunto ortogonal de funciones, todas ellas de norma 1, de longitud 1. Son funciones ortogonales unitarias, ¿okay? De manera que ellas también, estas funciones eran linealmente independientes y los coeficientes en esta representación, en caso de que F se pudiera escribir así, se calculaban de esta manera. ¿Okay? Entonces, vamos a comenzar hoy a hablar de la serie de Fourier. La serie de Fourier, como veremos, están íntimamente ligadas a este tipo de funciones. Y vamos a ver, además, algunas propiedades de esta serie de Fourier. Ok, entonces, comencé. First, we give a definition. The definition is the definition of the Fourier coefficients of a function f. So let's consider first a periodic function. Remember that the periodic function means that the period of this function is 1. Okay. F is a function from R to C, a periodic function. And Riemann integrable. On the interval 0, 1. That is to say that this integral exists. Okay. So you have the periodicity of the function and integrability also. Note that the interval is 0, 1 because in any interval of length 1, the function has the same values. Okay, these numbers, the numbers C sub K of F defined as the inner product of F and E sub K, which is the integral from 0 to 1 of F times the exponential function for K, an integral number, are called, these numbers are called the Fourier coefficients of the function F. And for this F, the following series is what we call the Fourier series of the function. This series is called the Fourier series. know that the series means, what that series means is that we have a sequence, and for this sequence, we take the limit when k goes to infinity. Okay. So when I said here Fourier series, what I mean is that we are considering a sequence. Okay. Note that this sequence, so the sequence considered above is the sequence of partial sums. Okay. As n of f, which is the sum from minus n to n of c sub k of f times e sub k of x. Then this series is just the limit of this sequence. Note that at this point, the convergence of this sequence is not considered. Okay, we need to see in what follows, what means that this series converges, in what sense we have the convergence in this case. But in order to do that, we need to define a norm and then a notion of convergence. But first, we have some notation. We will denote as by this R of R over C is the space of all integrable and periodic functions. These functions are periodic functions on R. These functions are defined on R, and these functions are complex value functions and Riemann integrable in the interval 0, 1. Note, as a remark, that this space, the space of all continuous functions, is a subspace of the integrable functions, periodic and integral functions, because every continuous function, as we know, is also an integrable function. Okay. And as an exercise, we can extend the definition of the inner product given in the space of periodic continuous function, given in this space, to the space of periodic and integrable functions. We can extend the inner product defined here to this space, to the bigger space. But in this case, however, this inner probe is no longer a positive definite. In this new space. This means that the inner product extended to the new space does not satisfy the positive definiteness of the inner product, of that part of the definition of the inner product. We have that this in general is not true, okay? That is the following property is not always true. And the exercise is to see that there are functions, periodic functions, and integrable, Riemann integrable, in the integral 0,1 that does not satisfy this property of the inner product. So the exercise consists to find a function in this space that the previous property is not true. Okay, that is the exercise. Now I want to see the notion of convergence for Fourier series. And the first step to do in that direction is to define the norm of in an space, okay? So let me call this section norms. Is there some question related with the previous section?
Can we still called as a inner product, or it has another name?
Okay. So let me define what a norm is. Given a vector space, V, a norm on V is a function which is usually denoted using bars defined on V and giving real numbers, returning real numbers, shows that we have the following three properties. The first property is the that the norm is positive definite. That means that pero me preguntan acá que si siempre se llama producto interno arriba, a pesar de que se cumple, a pesar, supongo que dice que a pesar de que no cumple con esa propiedad, bueno, no sería un producto interno. Lo que pasa es que se extiende al producto interno anterior, solo que falla esa propiedad. ¿Okay? El problema es, en esta propiedad, el problema está básicamente aquí. ¿Ok? Y no en la parte de ser mayor o igual que cero. ¿Sí? Ahorita vamos a ver que en el caso de la norma, este producto interno o esta no exactamente un producto interno, sino casi, o uno podría decir semiproducto interno, define una norma o más bien una seminorma. ¿Okay? Lo que pasa es que en el caso en el que vamos a estar considerando nosotros a las funciones, que son funciones continuas, realmente vamos a tener una norma. ¿Okay? A pesar de que esto no es un producto interno porque falla esta propiedad, esta parte de acá es la que falla. ¿Okay? Bueno, de hecho, acá tenemos que esta propiedad uno podría verla como un sí solo sí, pero una de las direcciones es directa a partir de la propiedad de linealidad del producto interno. Así que basta con ver esta en la definición, basta con colocar esta parte nada más, y esa es la parte que falla en esta extensión que se hace. No es ya un producto interno porque falla en una de las propiedades, pero casi. Ok, continuamos acá con la definición de la norma. Ok, a norm on a vector space V is just a function which is positive definite. This means that the norm of F is greater or equal than zero for all elements in the vector space. And the norm of F is equal to zero if and only if the function or the vector F is equal to zero. As a second property, we have the multiplication property, which means that when one multiplies some function or some vector with A and takes its norm, this is equal to the absolute value of A times the norm of F, the vector. Here, I'm going to consider not just a vector space, but a complex vector space. Okay, and so in this case, this norm corresponds to the norm of the complex number A. A is a complex number, and F is an element in the vector space. And finally, we have the triangle inequality. Okay, this inequality is true. And this is true for all A and G in the vector space. Well, using the previous extension of the inner product, remember that the inner product defined on the space of continuous and periodic functions was this inner product. Okay. Using this inner product, or the extension of this inner product to the space of integrable functions, we can define a norm. Okay. F now a continuous function, not just integrable, but a continuous. We need a continuity here in order to ensure that the norm is a norm, okay? In order to ensure that this part of the definition of norm holds. Let F here and define as before the inner product. Remember that remember that these functions are periodic functions, so we need only to see the integral on the interval 0, 1. Okay. Well, define now the norm of the function f as the square root of the inner product of f with f. Okay. Proposition as a proposition. I'm going to write this norm as the norm sub 2. Okay. Well, the reason for this is that this inner product is the inner product of functions belonging to a special space, which is called the L2 space. Okay. So it has sense to write this norm as the norm 2 because it's the norm of functions belonging to the L2 space. The proposition says that this norm, this is a norm. And is a norm on this space. So we have these three properties. Okay, let's see the proof of this proposition. The first property is is a consequence of the properties of the inner product. Okay. By the positive definiteness, of the inner product, we see that the norm of F, which is equal to this square root, is greater or equal than 0 for all F in the space. Okay, that is true because the inner product, one of the properties of the inner product, one of the properties of the inner product is this. You have positive definiteness. And also, and moreover, the norm of f is equal to zero if and only if the inner product of f is equal of f with f is equal to zero, and this is true if and only if f is equal to zero because of the positive definiteness of the inner product. We have that this inner product is equal to zero if and only if b is equal to zero. So the inner product of f with f is equal to zero if and only if the function itself is zero. Okay, so the first property of the norm, of the definition of a norm, is true. The second property is also a consequence of the definition of the inner product. Okay. We see that the, if we have a complex number, then the norm of A times F is equal to, by definition, the norm, the square root of this inner product. But remember that the inner product is linear in the first coordinate. So when we take this square root in the inside the square root, we have a because the inner product is linear in the first coordinate, so we can take this a and put outside of the inner product, and is antilinear in the second property, in the second coordinate. Remember that this means that if you take in this exercise, if you take A in the second coordinate, then you can put A bar outside the inner product, okay? If A is in the first coordinate, as in this property, A is equal inside or outside that inner product. In the case of the second coordinate, no. So here we have A, the first coordinate, and put A outside the inner product, just as was before. And A bar, because this A, the second coordinate, must be in the outside the inner product with a bar, with the conjugation. And so we have that this square root is equal to this. Then A times A bar becomes equal to the norm, the norm to the square. Okay. And the inner product of F with F is the same as before. So we have the norm of A times the square root of this inner product. And this is exactly the norm of F, or the absolute value A times the norm of F. So the second property of a norm, this property, is also true. Okay. The third property is a little more difficult, and it depends on the following inequality. This inequality is a well-known inequality called the Cauchy-Schwarz and sometimes Bunyakovsky inequality. And the following inequality. Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So in order to prove the third part of the proposition, we need to prove first this Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Okay. Let f and g continuous and periodic functions. Then the absolute value of the inner product of f and g is less or equal than the norm of f. The norm is norm sub 2. Here is norm sub 2 of f and norm sub 2, the 2 norm of g. Okay. Wait a moment, please. Okay. Consider the following function. Let me put here h of t equal to Dime un momento, por favor. Okay, we have this function. The function is f times t. T is a real number. Okay. The inner product of f times t with f times t, f times t plus g, and the same function. This function is obviously greater or equal than zero because we have the inner product of a function with the same function. Okay. Here, t is a real number. By the properties of the inner product, we see that h can be written as the f times t, the inner product with f times t plus f times t with g plus g with f times t and the inner product of G with G. Okay. In this part, we have the norm of T. Well, here, since T is a real number, in this case, since T is a real number, when one take the conjugate of that real number, because this real number and this number is in the second coordinate, when we take this norm of this real number, that conjugate, the conjugate of that real number, the conjugate is the same real number. So in this inner product, we have this inner product is equal to T squared times F, okay? This is equal to T times the inner product of F and G. Here we have T times the inner product of G times F. And finally, G times G. We can write this as T squared times the norm 2 to the square of F plus T times the inner product of F and G plus the inner product of F and G but conjugate plus the norm of G to the square. Okay, note that whenever one has a complex number C, for example, C is X plus IY, and its conjugate X minus IY, then the sum of these two complex numbers, C plus C bar, is equal to 2 times its real part, 2 times X. And X is the real part of the number of complex number C or the complex number C bar. So we have that H of T is equal to T squared times the norm of F squared plus T 2 times T times the real part of the inner product of F and G plus the norm of G. Okay. This is H. That is, H is a quadratic polynomial on the variable T. And as all of us know, this polynomial has a minimum because the coefficient of T squared is positive. This coefficient is a non-negative number because F could be the zero function. But so this a polynomial which has a minimum. Okay, a minimum. This minimum has a minimum at T sub zero, where T sub zero is such that the derivative, the first derivative of the function h is equal to zero. Since the derivative of this function is equal to t squared, two times t times the norm of f squared plus two times the real part of the inner product f and g. Then h has a minimum. At this point, at t sub zero equal to minus the real part of this inner product over the square of this norm. Okay. At this point, the h attains its minimum value. So this means wait a moment. Okay, so we have that h in t sub zero is equal to according to this formula, h at t sub zero is equal to this square, okay. Times this is equal to the real part of this inner product to the square over this norm to the square minus two times t times this is minus two times the real part to the square over this norm to the square plus this g square. Okay, remember that this function is a non-negative function. Okay, so we have that h evaluated at any point t is greater or equal than zero. In particular, this is true for the point t sub zero just calculated. So we have that this h of t sub zero is greater or equal than zero. And this h of t sub zero can be written as the, here is minus the real part of the inner product of a and g to the square over the norm of f to the square. This plus the norm of g square, but this is greater or equal than zero, so we have that the real part of this inner product to the square is less or equal than the product of these two norms. And this implies that the real part of this inner product, the norm of this, or the absolute value of this inner product, is less or equal than the product of the norms. Okay, we have this inequality, which I will call star. Okay. On the other hand, since h is greater or equal than zero, this h Since this age is equal to this quadratic polynomial is greater or equal than zero, then the discriminant of the quadratic polynomial must be less or equal than zero. Then its discriminant must be less or equal than zero. That is, the discriminant, remember that the discriminant of any quadratic polynomial, ax t squared, if you have a quadratic polynomial a squared plus bt plus c, the discriminant of this quadratic polynomial is b squared minus 4 times ac. Okay, this number says if the function, if the quadratic polynomial has roots or no. When this discriminant is negative, this quadratic polynomial has no real roots. That is the case when the, for example, the quadratic polynomial is positive. If this quadratic polynomial is zero, if we have the possibility that is equal to zero, then this discriminant is not just negative, could be equal to zero also. Okay, so in this case, who is playing the role of A is this norm to the square. B is 2 times this real part, and this is C. So that the discriminant is less or equal than zero means that b to the square 4 times the real part of this inner product to the square minus 4 times ac, 4 times this product of norms is negative. Just wait. Okay. This is another way to see, this implies that the real part of the inner product the norm of this real part is less or equal than the product of norms. So this is another way to see the inequality stuff. Okay. Is there some question so far?
No, profe.
Okay. Well, ¿alguna pregunta?
No, profe.
Okay. As an exercise, think about how to use this result to obtain the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Well, the only thing that we need in order to prove the third part, this third part of the definition of a norm is inequality star. So that's the reason why I stopped the proof of the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality with this and use this exercise to finish that proof, because the only thing that we need to that proof is inequality star. So a proof of three of the proposition. Okay. Note that giving any complex number, see, we have that the real part of C, let me write C as X plus IY. Okay. C is equal to Sorry. Okay. Wait a moment, this está un poco lento esto, okay. Disculpen. Okay, given any complex number C equal to X plus IY, we have that the real part of Z is equal to X, and then the norm of this, the absolute value of the real part of Z is equal to the absolute value of X. This absolute value of X can be seen as the square root of X squared, and this is less or equal than the square root of X squared plus Y squared. This is just the norm of or the absolute value of the complex number C. That is what we have in this chain of equalities and inequalities, is that the absolute value of the real part of any complex number is less or equal than the absolute value of the complex number. We have in particular that the absolute value of the real part of the inner product of this real part of the inner product of F and G is less or equal than the absolute value of the back of the complex number. This is the complex number C in the previous inequality. So this absolute value of the real part of this inner product is less or equal than this absolute value. Okay. On the other hand, the norm of F plus G, the norm to the square, is equal to the inner product of F plus G and F plus U. And this is equal to the inner product of F with F plus the F with F. Inner product of F and G plus the inner product of G with F and the inner product of G with G. This is equal to the norm, the two norm of the of F, the two norm squared plus two times the real part of this inner product. Okay. Plus the norm to the square of G. And this is less or equal than this norm to the square to plus two times the absolute value of this real part, because any real number is less or equal than its absolute value. Okay. The other two terms are the same. This is less or equal than this norm to the square plus two times the absolute value using this inequality. We have that this absolute value, the absolute value of the real part of the inner product of F and G, is less or equal than two times the absolute value of the inner product of F and G. So this and this is equal to Okay. Is less or equal, this is less or equal than A, this norm plus 2 times the norm of F times the norm of G plus this norm to the square. This is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, and this finally is equal to the norm of F plus the norm of G, this sum to the square. Okay. Which implies that the norm of F plus G is less or equal than the sum of the norms. Which is the triangle inequality. Okay, this completes the proof of the triangle inequality, the third part of the definition of the norm for this norm, for the norm and the norm two, given using this square root of the inner product. So we have that actually, that indeed, this norm is a norm on this space. Okay. Note that in view of the positive definiteness of the inner product in the integrable functions, the integrable function space, then this norm is not positive definite in the case when the space function, the space of functions considered, is the space of integrable function. So we can extend also this norm to this other space, the space of all Riemann integrable functions. But the problem is that in that space, this is not a norm. We have that this is what we call a semi-norm. It is almost a norm, whole with the other properties, but fails with an property. The property in which this function fails to be a norm is the property that says that if f is equal to zero, then the norm of f is equal to zero, then f is equal to zero. This property is not true when one considers functions in this space, okay? In the case of the continuous functions space, we have that this is a norm, but in its extension to the integrable function fails to be a norm. It's not a norm, but a semi-norm. Now, in order to see the notion of convergence for the Fourier series, we have to see a very important inequality first. This inequality is related with the norm defined previously. And this inequality is called the Bessel's inequality. The Bessel's inequality establishes that if one has an integrable function, a periodic integrable function, then the series of the Fourier coefficients to the square can be estimated by an integral. Okay, and this inequality is as follows. Let f an integrable and periodic function, a function here, whose coefficients, Fourier coefficients are c sub k. I will write c sub k of f just as c sub k. Then the Fourier, the Bessel's inequality establishes that this series of the norms or absolute values of the coefficients to the square is less or equal than this integral. Okay. Or in other terms, this series is less or equal than the square, the two norm of f to the square. Okay, it's just the same inequality, but written in different ways. Well, in order to prove this inequality, we need the following result. We prove the following result. This is a lemma. Consider a function f, an integrable function f, and k, and for k, an integral number, but c sub k has it as the Fourier coefficients of f, that is f is equal to this inner product. Then, for all natural numbers, n, we can write this norm as the difference of these two expressions. Note that this equality, let me put this equality as one, establishes also, as a remark before the proof, note that one implies that this norm to the square is greater or equal than the sum. Because this is a non-negative number, okay? Since this is the square of a norm is of course a non-negative number. And since this is equal to this difference, then we can write this inequality. Okay. Letting to finish the remark, letting n goes to infinite in this inequality. We have the Bessel inequality. So the proof of the Bessel inequality is a consequence, an immediate consequence of this lemma, of the equation one, okay? Because from equation one, this remark says that we have this inequality, and when one takes n going to infinity, we have that this sequence becomes, the series becomes equal to the series, and on the right hand side of this inequality we have the same law. So when n goes to infinity in this inequality, one has exactly this inequality, that is the Bessel inequality. So all what we need to do in order to prove this Bessel inequality is to prove the lemma, okay? So let's prove the lemma. Proof of the lemma. Let G be equal to the sum from minus n to n of C sub k times E sub k. E sub k, remember, is given, is the exponential function. Okay. E sub k is the exponential function defined in the previous class, this exponential function. By the properties of the inner product, we have that the inner product of F and G is equal to this inner product, F with the sum, C sub K times E sub k, k equal to from minus n to n. And we can write this as the sum using the linearity or the additivity of the inner product. In the second coordinate, we have the sum from minus n to n of the inner product of F, C sub k, E sub k. But C sub k are numbers, are complex numbers. So since this complex number is in the second coordinate, we can put outside the inner product using the conjugation, Okay, so this is equal to k, the sum from minus n to n of the conjugate of C sub k times F C sub k. But these numbers are precisely the Fourier coefficients. Remember that Fourier coefficients, by definition, are here. The Fourier coefficients are these numbers. The inner product of F with the exponential function is okay. So since this number is Shizuke, this expression becomes equal to the sum. Shizuke bar times Shizuke. But this is the norm of Shizuke, or the absolute value of Shizuke to the square. Summarizing, we have that F times G, the inner product of F and G, is exactly the same as the sum from minus n to n of these absolute, the squares of these absolute values. Okay. On the other hand, the inner product of G with G the inner product of G and G is equal to the inner product of G with the sum from minus n to n of a C sub k, A sub k. Okay, by definition, G is this, the sum. So the inner product of G with G is equal to this inner product. Again, we can use the properties of the inner product and say that this inner product can be written as this sum. If one writes G as before using its definition, then we can see that the previous sum is equal to this one. G will be written in terms of its definition. That is, G will be written now as this sum. But in this case, the indices of the sum will be called J. So is C sub J, E sub J, from J equal to minus N to N. And here times is K. So the sum becomes equal to the sum from K and J equal to minus N to N is a double sum of C sub K times C sub J times E sub J times E sub K. But remember that these functions, these exponential functions, are orthonormal function. That is, we have that the inner product of E sub K with E sub L, in this case, E sub J with E sub K, is equal to the Kronecker's delta. So this sum is equal to the sum from minus n to n of C sub K bar C sub J times the Kronecker's delta of delta sub J K. And as you know, this function, this Kronecker's delta is equal to 1 if J and K are the same number and is 0 otherwise. So the only elements surviving in this sum are those in which J and K have the same value. This means that this is the sum from K equal to minus N to N of C sub K bar times C sub K. And delta K, but this delta KK is equal to 1. So it disappears, and this product, C sub K bar times C sub K, is the absolute value of C sub K to the square. So this sum is equal to this sum. That is the inner product of G with G is again the sum of these absolute values to the square. Just as in this case, we have this this equality and also this one. That sum can be computed using the inner product of F and G, but also using this inner product of G and G. Okay. Now, consider the expression the norm of this with difference to the square. Okay. This norm is equal by definition as the inner product of F minus G with F minus G. The inner product of this function with the same function. And this inner product is the norm of F to the square minus the inner product of G times F times G minus the inner product of J of G times F plus the norm of G squared. Okay. Well, note that since this inner product is equal to this sum, you have to know that this sum is a real number. Okay, so this implies that F times G conjugate is the same number because this is a real number. The conjugate of any real numbers is the same real number. So this and this are the same numbers. Okay. That means that you have here this norm squared minus this sum, okay, equal to minus n to n two of these absolute values to the square. And each of these terms, the second, third, and fourth terms in this is a sum. Have the same value. Here we have minus and here we have plus. So this is this norm to the square minus this sum. But this is greater or equal than zero. So we have our inequality. This completes the proof. Okay. Déjeme, voy a recapitular lo que hemos visto hasta ahora, pero ahora en español. Tenemos los coeficientes de Fourier definidos de esta manera. Una función da una función integrable y periódica en el intervalo 0, 1, más bien periódica e integrable en el intervalo 0, 1. Este es su coeficiente de Fourier. Estamos interesados en estudiar este tipo de series, ¿ok? Y estas series son es lo que se llama la serie de Fourier de F. Esa serie depende del coeficiente de Fourier y los coeficientes de Fourier de F. Y además, cuando uno habla de esta serie, en realidad se está refiriendo a la sucesión que después, para obtener la serie, uno toma n tendiendo infinito. ¿Okay? Ahora, me había dicho acá con respecto a la norma, bueno, que una norma estaba definida de esta manera, tenemos este producto interno y dado cualquier producto interno, el producto interno, debido a que se cumple la desigualdad de Cauchy-Schwarz para cualquier producto interno, real o complejo, implica que lo que se tiene mediante esta definición siempre es una norma, ¿ok? En el espacio en donde se está, en donde se definió, donde se tenía el producto interno. En este caso, acá. Vimos que ese producto interno y también la norma se extienden a las funciones integrables, pero sin cumplir la propiedad de ser positiva definida, o por lo menos una parte de esa propiedad. Entonces no es ni producto interno en un caso, ni norma en el otro. Uno podría, yo no sé si así le llaman en la literatura, la verdad es que no lo he visto de esa manera para el caso del producto interno, pero sí para la norma. En el caso del producto interno uno podría llamarlo un semiproducto interno, no lo he visto de esa forma, pero lo llamo, me atrevo a llamarlo así porque para la norma, cuando satisface todas las propiedades menos esa de menos esta parte, menos esta parte de la norma, o más bien, ¿cuál sería esta parte? Uno le llama una seminorma. Eso sí está en la literatura. Por eso digo que el otro probablemente habrá quien le llame semiproducto interno. Ok, entonces esto es una norma acá. Lo que se demuestra con relativa facilidad, por lo menos las primeras dos propiedades, la tercera depende de la desigualdad de Cauchy-Schwarz. Ok, acá. En realidad lo que hice yo no fue mostrar la desigualdad de Cauchy-Schwarz, sino mostrar esta desigualdad asterisco de dos maneras distintas. ¿Okay? Ahora, ¿cómo se demuestra la desigualdad de Cauchy-Schwarz a partir de esta desigualdad asterisco? Bueno, ese es el ejercicio, ¿no? Pensar en cómo se llega a esta desigualdad usando la desigualdad asterisco. ¿Ok? Ahora, bueno, mostramos también la desigualdad triangular y esta parte, la desigualdad de Bessel, tiene que ver con que yo puedo acotar o estimar esta serie por medio de la norma de esta norma. ¿Ok? Entonces, fíjense que ahora lo que vamos a hacer guarda relación con lo que acabamos de hacer con la desigualdad de Bessel. ¿En qué sentido? Bueno, en que hasta ahora nosotros definimos lo que o hemos trabajado con las funciones que son continuas, periódicas y continuas, recuerden el periodo es 1, integrables también en el intervalo 0, 1, pero uno quisiera que esta expresión que está acá, que no es más que la norma 2, ¿ok? De la función, que esa expresión sea finita, ¿ok? En el caso nuestro lo es, ¿ok? Porque la función que estamos tomando, f, es una función acá. Y como es una función ahí, ella es integrable y su norma, su valor absoluto también lo es, porque, bueno, No, el valor absoluto es una función, el valor absoluto es una función continua, y entonces eso no le quita la integrabilidad. Ok, sigue siendo integrado. Entonces, tenemos que esta serie de coeficientes, de módulos de coeficiente de Fourier al cuadrado, siempre es convergente. Y es convergente porque este número existe, es finito. Entonces, la desigualdad de Bessel establece la convergencia de esta serie debido a que esto es menor o igual que este número que es finito. Y por supuesto, esto es una serie de números no negativos. Y nosotros sabemos que una serie de números no negativos converge si solo si está acotada y esta está acotada. ¿Okay? Eso es lo que estamos viendo. La desigualdad de Bessel lo que establece es eso, ¿no? Pero como decía acá en esta observación con respecto al lema, es que esta desigualdad de Bessel no es más que una consecuencia directa de esta desigualdad. ¿Okay? Esta desigualdad, bueno, de hecho aquí al final, ni siquiera tengo que escribir esto. Allí ya termina la prueba porque lo que se estaba buscando mostrar era que esta diferencia era mayor o igual que cero. Y eso fue lo que mostramos. Entonces, yo decía que la desigualdad de Bessel era una consecuencia directa de este lema porque este lema implica, ¿verdad? Que esta norma es mayor o igual que esta suma. Cuando uno hace n tener infinito, se tiene la desigualdad de Bessel. Fíjense ustedes que aquí en esta última parte de la demostración se considera esta expresión porque esta expresión es precisamente la expresión que aparece acá. ¿Ok? Y se define en la demostración, se define esto que está acá porque eso que yo llamé G es precisamente lo que está aquí, ¿ok? O sea, no fue algo sacado debajo de la manga ni nada, sino que según lo que tenemos en esta expresión, esa sería la que definimos, esa es la que definimos y usamos eso para demostrar lo que queremos. Al final, la expresión que se usa, que se estudia es esta, porque es precisamente la que se tiene por acá, la que se quiere ver que es igual a esta. ¿Ok? ¿Está claro?
Sí, profe.
Bien. Entonces, lo que vamos a hacer ahora es que vamos a estudiar un tipo de convergencia que tiene que ver precisamente con esta integral o con esta norma, que al final es lo mismo, ¿no? Que es la norma en L2, para lo cual pues vamos a definir ese tipo de convergencia. ¿Ok? Además, una cosa más es que debido a la forma en que se construye la serie de Fourier, la convergencia en L2 que vamos a definir ahora es la más adecuada. Bueno, porque precisamente la manera de conseguir los coeficientes de Fourier es por medio de un producto interno que además me permite definir lo que es la norma L2. Por eso resulta natural estudiar la convergencia de la serie de Fourier en ese espacio. Entonces vamos a hablar ahora convergencia en L2. Voy a detener la grabación un par de minutos y vuelvo un momento, ¿okay? Para continuar con el tema de la convergencia en la norma L2, voy a definir un par de tipos de convergencia, ¿no? Lo primero es lo siguiente. Vamos a definir. Okay, a sequence of functions f sub n is said to converge uniformly to a function f on an interval I if giving a positive epsilon, there exists a natural number n sub zero such that this inequality f of x minus f of x sub zero f of x minus f sub n of x is less than epsilon for all n greater than n sub zero and all x in the interval I. Okay. F is said to converge pointwise lead to f sub n, sorry, is said to converge pointwise to f at x sub zero or at x, if there is giving epsilon, giving a positive epsilon, there exists a natural number n sub zero such that this inequality is true for all n greater than n sub zero. Note that in the pointwise convergence, in this case, the convergence is at the point x, while in the uniform convergence, the convergence is on this interval I. So there is a big difference because here this n sub zero is made the world only for this point x, but this n sub zero the inequality, the modulus of f of x minus f sub n of x less than epsilon is true not only for one x in the interval I, but for all the elements in that interval. Okay. In the point-wise convergence is just for that point X, not for all the points in the interval I. For example, this sequence is f sub n of x equal to x to the n power defined on this interval 1, this interval I equal to 1. Converges point wise to this form. The function f of x equal to 0 if x is less than 1 and 1 if x is equal to 1. Okay. This is true because, in fact, if x is equal to 1, for example, then clearly f sub n of x is equal to 1 also, which converges when n goes to infinity, this limit is equal to 1. So when x is equal to 1, the limit function is equal to 1. Okay. So we have that at this point, x equal to 1, the sequence of functions converges to the function 1. Or the value of the limit function at this point is equal to 1. That this is f of 1. Okay. And if x is in the interval 0, 1, let me put two more cases. The second case, is this. If x is equal to 0, f of n, f sub n of 0 is equal to 0, which converges also in this case to 0, and then goes to infinity. And finally, the last case is the case when x belongs to the open interval 0, 1. In this case, f sub n of x, which is equal to x to the n power, obviously goes to 0 when n goes to infinity. Because you know that any this sequence, the sequence of numbers, if you fix a number x, any number x in this interval, that number is just that the modulus of that number is less than 1. And you know that in that case, x to the n power goes to 0 when n goes to 0. That is a well-known fact about the sequences of real numbers. Okay. In this case, this corresponds, in the second case, the limit value corresponds to the function, and the limit function at which I am calling f evaluated at 0. Okay. And in the third case, this is the limit function at any point x where x is in the open interval 0, 1. So this is the limit function. The limit function of this sequence of functions is exactly this function defined as zero when x is less than one. Of course, this is in the interval 0, 1, including zero, but not one, and is one when x is equal to one. So here I should write when x is less or equal, greater or equal than zero and less than one. Okay. In this case, f converges to zero, or epsilon converges to zero, and in the case when x is equal to one, the sequence converges to one. But note that this convergence is a bondwise convergence, okay? Because we are considering the points separately in this sequence. Okay, it's not a uniform convergence, and as an exercise, think about this question: why is not a uniform convergence? Well, there is a, I don't know how to say that, there is an answer, but that answer depends on a result that is a well-known result, but I don't know if you know this result. It's a function if you have a sequence of continuous functions, okay? And this function, this sequence converges to another function, and this convergence is uniform, then the limit function is also continuous, okay? If these are continuous and this convergence is uniform, then the limit function is continuous. Okay, well, this convergence cannot be a uniform convergence because these functions are all of them continuous in this interval, but its limit function, the limit function of the sequence is not continuous. So this convergence cannot be a uniform convergence, okay? Because there is a theorem that establishes that when you have a sequence of continuous functions converging uniformly to a function, the limit function must be continuous also. In this case, this is not the situation, okay? So that is a possible answer, but depends on that result. You can see my suggestion is that you see the definitions of uniform convergence and pointwise convergence and try to answer that question using these definitions. Okay, anyway, there is a very important criteria or test to say when a sequence of functions is a uniform, converges uniformly to other functions. But this criteria is established in terms of series, okay? This is the M-test, the bias as M-test. So the exercise is to prove this test. Prove this by stress and test. Suppose that you have a sequence of functions. The sequence of functions defined by these sums. The sum from k equal to 1 to n and of a sub k of x. Okay, where a sub k are functions for a sequence of functions a sub k. So a sub k of x and x in the interval I. Suppose that there is a sequence of positive real numbers C sub k. These C sub k, let me put in instead of C sub k, M sub k. Because these C sub k's are not the C sub k's, the Fourier coefficients. No, it's just a sequence of positive real numbers. Okay. And this sequence, satisfies that each of the terms in this sum, a sub k of x, has modulus less or equal than m sub k. This for every natural number k. And every x in the interval I. Finally, suppose that this sum, the series converges. The series from k for k in the natural numbers is a convergent series. Well, the conclusion of the n bias, the Weierstrass m test, is that this sequence of functions converges uniformly. Then, the sequence f sub n converges uniformly to this function. To the function f equal to the sum from 1 to infinite of a sub k of x. Okay. Déjeme explicar esto en español. Hay un criterio muy usado en análisis para garantizar la convergencia uniforme de sucesiones de funciones. ¿Okay? Pero no de todas las sucesiones de funciones, sino más de sucesiones de funciones que vienen definidas por medio de sumas. Así. Entonces, básicamente, lo que yo estoy pidiendo mostrar acá es mostrar ese criterio, el criterio M de Weierstrass, así se llama. Y ese criterio lo que establece es que si yo tengo una sucesión de funciones definida por medio de estas sumas y tengo otra sucesión de números reales positivos, M sub K, que acotan a los términos de la sucesión, a los términos de estas sumas parciales, okay. o a los términos caésimos, se le llamaría en este caso, no enésimo, sino caésimo de la suma definida arriba, y lo acota en todo el intervalo. Fíjense que eso, para cada k, para cada término a sub k, hay un número real m sub k que acota ese a sub k, pero no solamente en un punto, sino en todo el intervalo. Si eso es así, y además esta serie converge, la serie de los de cuyos términos k-ésimos son los números positivos estos de la sucesión, entonces la función así definida converge a esta función. Y no solo converge, sino que lo hace uniformemente. La manera de demostrar eso es bastante fácil, porque esencialmente lo que uno hace es usar el hecho, bueno, ¿qué es lo que uno quiere ver? Lo que uno quiere ver es que esto es menor que epsilon. Si a uno le da un epsilon positivo, esto es menor que epsilon, va a existir un n0 natural, y esto va a ser cierto para todo n0, pero n mayor que n0. Ok. Y x en y. Pero fíjense ustedes que esa desigualdad va a ser cierta gracias a que yo voy a poder acotar esto así. Bueno, ¿cómo podríamos ver esto para que sea más claro? Es que la idea de esto para ver, bueno, fíjense una cosa, ¿no? Lo primero que hay que notar es lo siguiente. Voy a borrar esto para que vean. Cuando uno tiene el hecho de que uno tenga esto, esta desigualdad, en todo el intervalo, y lo que significa es que entonces yo tengo esta desigualdad desde k igual a 1 hasta n en todo el intervalo i. ¿Verdad? Eso pasa para todo x. Pero resulta que esto, por supuesto, esta es una sucesión que ustedes pueden llamar S sub n de x si quieren. Y esta es otra sucesión que voy a llamar, qué sé yo, vamos a llamarle R sub n. Ya. Fíjense que en el lado izquierdo, lo que uno tiene es una sucesión de módulos, de suma de módulos. Acá esta sucesión converge, porque esa es una de las hipótesis. Cuando yo hago n tender a infinito, esto converge. Y esto es una sucesión para cada x en el intervalo i, es una sucesión acotada, porque está acotada por esto y esta tiene límite. Ok. Y además una sucesión de números positivos para cada x en el intervalo i. De manera que esto va a converger también. Es decir, converge absolutamente la serie esta. Okay. Y si la serie converge absolutamente, ella, sin los valores absolutos, también converge. Porque la convergencia absoluta implica la convergencia. Entonces, en principio, tiene sentido hablar de esta expresión, porque esa expresión converge. Es convergente para cada x en el intervalo. Entonces, todo lo que hay que ver ahora es que la convergencia es uniforme. Ok. Bueno, ¿qué podría uno hacer allí? Bueno, la verdad es que no recuerdo ahorita. En verdad no es complicado el asunto, pero por alguna razón tengo un pequeño lapsus ahí. Pero bueno, la cuestión es que la convergencia está garantizada gracias a esto que acabo de decir. La convergencia uniforme tiene que ver es con este hecho, con el hecho de que esto ocurre para todo X. Ok, ese es el meollo del asunto. Ahorita no recuerdo exactamente el argumento que se usa allí. Me parece que es que uno considera lo siguiente. Si yo no recuerdo mal, es más, me parece que la situación es así. Uno considera fn de x y en lugar de considerar f de x, este módulo, ¿sí? Uno lo que hace es considerar fm de x. ¿Ok? Este fm de x, bueno, usa esta expresión, la tiene que acotar por arriba. ¿Ok? Y esa cota va a depender de, bueno, primero el hecho de que esto está acotado para todo x en y, y además que esto es finito, va a permitir dar una cota acá, pero ahí es donde no recuerdo bien cómo es el asunto, pero bueno, esa cota se da y al final uno lo que hace es hacer m tender a infinito y el n lo deja fijo. Entonces, eso da la. Bueno, en todo caso, vamos a continuar. Ok, la próxima clase trataré de darles la idea más clara. Pero en principio la convergencia, como dije, está garantizada, es decir, puedo definir una función f cuyo límite es el límite de esa sucesión y esa es esta. Ok, y bueno, nada, simplemente ver ahora que se cumple la definición de convergencia uniforme, que dado epsilon positivo existe un natural a partir del cual esta desigualdad es cierta, no solo para n más grande que n sub 0, sino para todo x en y. Okay. Pero si no estoy mal, el argumento va por ahí de considerar fn menos fm. Okay. Bueno. Ok, en todo caso, lo que nos interesa a nosotros es lo que había colocado aquí como subtítulo de la sección, la convergencia en L2. Ahora, vamos a definir lo que es ese tipo de convergencia. Ok, y vamos a ver la relación que se guarda entre este tipo de convergencia y la que definimos antes, la convergencia uniforme. Ok. Bien. definition, consider now a function f in this space, a Riemann integrable function, the integral 0,1, a periodic in all the real line, and f sub n be a sequence in this space, a sequence of functions in the same space. We say that F sub n converges in the L2 norm, converges in the L2 norm to the function f if this limit, when n goes to infinite of the norm of this difference, is equal to 0. In other words, f sub n converges in the L2 norm to f if given a positive epsilon, there exists a natural number n sub 0 such that this norm, the norm of this difference, is less or equal, is less than epsilon for all n greater than n sub 0, greater or equal than n sub 0. Okay. That is the definition of the convergence in the L2 norm. Okay. As a first result, relating this type of convergences, we have this leg. Or let me put this as a proposition. If S sub n converges uniformly to f on the interval 0,1, then f sub n also converges to f in the L2 norm. This means that the uniform convergence is stronger than the L2 norm convergence, okay? Because any sequence converging uniformly to a function f in the interval 0,1 will also converge to the same function now in the L2 norm. The proof is very simple. Because we have the following. Let epsilon positive, okay, in order to see that f sub n converges to f in the L2 norm, we need to see that given a positive epsilon, there exists an n sub 0, so that this norm is less than epsilon for all n greater or equal than n sub 0. But since the function, since the function, the sequence of functions converges uniformly to F, there exists a positive, a natural number n sub zero, such that this inequality, let me put in the modulus of f sub x minus f sub n of x is less than epsilon for all n greater than or equal than n sub zero and all x in the interval 0, 1. That is the definition of uniform convergence in this case, okay? So the norm, I want to see, the idea here is to see that this norm is also less than epsilon for some, for n greater than n sub zero. That n sub zero in this case will be the same n sub zero as here. Okay, so we need to consider this expression, the norm of this difference. This norm is by definition the integral in the interval 0, 1 of the absolute value of a sub f of x, this is here f minus f sub n, f of x minus f sub n of x squared dx. Okay, this is the definition of the two norm. But this is less or equal than the integral between 0 and 1 of epsilon squared, okay? Dx, because this expression is less than epsilon in all the intervals 0, 1. So this norm, this absolute value, square is less than epsilon square. Okay, here actually we should write less than this integral. Okay. And this is equal to epsilon square, which is a okay, here is square, because if not, I should write this to the 1/2 power. Okay, this is 1/2. And this is epsilon. And this is exactly what we tried to do. But we have that this norm is less than epsilon for n greater or equal than n sub zero. Okay, this completes the proof. And you know, if you have some question.
O sea, profe, por eso es que no hay convergencia puntual, ¿no? Porque no es para todo el intervalo. O sea, tocaría considerar nada más una X en particular.
Bueno, voy a recapitular esta parte en español. Aquí tenemos la convergencia en L2, es simplemente una convergencia en donde la norma involucrada es la norma 2, no más que eso. ¿Okay? Entonces, decir que Fn converge a F en la norma L2 es decir que este límite vale 0. Entonces, eso se puede traducir en términos de epsilon y n sub 0 así. Dado epsilon positivo, existe un n sub 0 tal que esta desigualdad es cierta a partir de n sub 0. Ahora, lo que mostramos es que la convergencia uniforme en el intervalo 0, 1 implica convergencia en la norma L2. Y eso lo que significa es que la convergencia uniforme es más fuerte que la convergencia en la norma L2, ¿ok? Porque toda sucesión que converge uniformemente a F en 0, 1 va a converger también en la norma L2. Entonces, la idea es acá simplemente notar que como tenemos convergencia uniforme, esto se cumple en todo el intervalo 0, 1, y el hecho de que esta integral acá sea en el intervalo 0, 1 hace que sea necesario que esto se cumpla en todo el intervalo 0, 1. Porque si se cumpliera solamente para un punto, pero para otros no, entonces yo no podría decir, yo no podría usar esta desigualdad. ¿Okay? Como si se cumple en todo el intervalo 0, 1, entonces no importa qué valor de x esté considerando yo en este integrando, eso siempre va a ser menor que epsilon. Bueno, que epsilon cuadrado, porque esto acá es al cuadrado. Ok, entonces, bueno, esta cadena de igualdades y desigualdades lleva a que para n más grande que n sub 0, que es en el sitio o a partir del n, el n a partir del cual esto se cumple, ok, en ese caso tenemos esta desigualdad. Alguien me preguntaba hace rato, ahorita, bueno, hace poco, que cree que su micrófono no funciona, y que entonces me decía que se puede decir que la convergencia puntual no implica la convergencia uniforme, porque no convergen todos los intervalos. Bueno, sí, porque es que la convergencia puntual, el problema con la convergencia puntual es que la convergencia puntual es como su nombre lo indica, es punto a punto. Okay. Y entonces, que converja puntualmente, lo que significa es que se cumple esta definición, okay, y eso significa que para cada epsilon positivo existe un n sub 0 con esta propiedad, pero ese n sub 0 depende no solamente del epsilon, sino que depende del punto en donde estamos ubicados. Okay. Depende de x. En cambio, acá el n sub 0 en la convergencia uniforme no depende de x, sino exclusivamente de epsilon. ¿Ok? Depende solo de epsilon. De manera que no importa qué x consideremos acá, esta desigualdad siempre se va a cumplir a partir del mismo n sub 0. Entonces, en cambio, cuando uno ve la convergencia puntual y cambia el punto en el que está considerando la sucesión de funciones, puede ser que siga convergiendo a la función que estoy tomando, como en este caso. Lo que pasa es que el n sub 0 ya no va a ser el mismo en todos los casos. No tiene por qué mantenerse el mismo n sub 0 para todo x. Y eso es lo que pasa acá. Porque fíjense qué pasa. Miren de dónde proviene que esto no sea uniformemente convergente. Bueno, está claro acá que dependiendo de quién sea X, el n sub 0 a partir del cual esto va a ser suficientemente pequeño, va a cambiar de un X a otro. ¿Okay? Porque si, por ejemplo, está claro también que sin importar aquí, como este F sub n, para x igual a 1 siempre vale 1, ahí no importa quién sea n sub 0, porque siempre f de x y f de f sub n va a ser 1 menos 1 y siempre va a ser el mismo valor y su diferencia va a ser 0. Entonces, eso va a ser más pequeño que cualquier epsilon positivo. A partir del propio de sub 0 igual a 1. ¿Sí? Pero eso no es cierto en este caso. O sea, la situación es que, además, la situación es que el n que uno considera acá va a depender del punto en donde uno está ubicado. ¿Ok? O el n sub 0, más bien. Entonces, claro, la convergencia puntual no implica la convergencia uniforme, porque la convergencia puntual en realidad es más débil y depende, el n sub 0 que uno escoge depende del x en donde uno está parado. En la convergencia uniforme no es así. La convergencia uniforme es más fuerte. ¿Okay? Y se dice que es uniforme precisamente por el hecho de que el n sub 0 que uno considera acá se toma de manera uniforme para todo x. ¿Okay? Y aquí se dice que es puntual porque el n sub 0 depende de cada punto. Ok, ¿alguna otra duda? Si no es así, vamos a dejar la clase en este punto. Okay. Nos vemos la próxima semana. Dios mediante.